Carter Bowden, Brother Michael Hazel, Sergeant Queen, Sister Jeanette Wallace, Sister Latoya Hall, Sister Hattie Wallace, Sister Michael Sutton, Charlie Brother Michael Sutton, Brother Clint Wallace, Sister Faith Jefferson, the Dale Ministry, Sister Blondell and Brother Herbert Caswell, Sister Brother Sapp, Brother Samuel Gunninger, Sister Fenton Sluckett, Dallas Frankfield Jr., Sister Barbara Johnson, Sister Michelle Walker, Sister Hilda Meyer, Quinn McCall, Lynn Wright, Sister Aspect, Eugene Davis Sr., Sheriff Cox, Sister Ramel Powell, Bobby Tucker Jr., Sister Allison, Sister Vanessa Sutton, Brother Ivory Goodman, Brother Nicholas and Andrew Giddens, Lloyd Smith, Sister Moody Taylor Sutton, Michael Donaldson, Carolyn Campbell, Tracy, Craig Cole, Brother Ethan Simmons, Bill Moore, and our very own Sister Rosemary Matthews, and all to the Lord. Homeboy, sir, we had the church at 11 o'clock. So if you can avail yourself, please come by and support the battle. I'm going to read a little scripture here. It says in Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge the Lord, and he shall direct your path. Let's have a little prayer before we start the service here. Father God, I want to thank you for allowing me to be a part of your creation. Lord, I thank you for being patient with me. And Lord, I want to reach out to all those who could not make it now, tonight. I'm sure that they have good reasons for they couldn't come, but as long as they can carry you in their heart, Lord, and just like this, you're here. Lord, I want to thank you for appointing the pastor as a leader of this local congregation. And I want to thank you, Lord, for each and everything that you have done for me, Lord. So, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Now, I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Gregory.
Thank you, Deacon Leith. We appreciate the devotion that you have started us off on. Again, I do want to apologize for the in starting. There has been a problem in the area, I'm understanding, for the last week or so with the internet. And it's not just St. Joseph. I understand that Bethel and other churches in the area have also been having a problem as far as streaming their services. So, but we are planning to get to the bottom of this and try to get it straight so that we can be on time with this and not have this as an interruption for our service. Again, we want to thank God for intervening and as he has touched hearts, and we do have a pastor here now at St. Joseph. And I thank God for favoring us and for blessing us the way that he's done. Pray now that we will all work together so that we can move forward St. Joseph, so that we can be the church that God is calling for, and that we can grow beyond measure, because God, I know, has wonderful things for us. Father, we thank you for this night. We thank you for your intervention. We thank you for your hand as you have laid it upon St. Joseph, as you have kept us through the time that we were moving along with our pastor. Pray and thank you for lifting our deacons, for they have done, as Pastor Rem would say, a Herculean job in keeping things together. And so, Father, I pray that you would bless them in a mighty way for their faithfulness. And now, Lord, as we prepare for our service tonight, I pray that you would forgive me of my sin and that you would touch our hearts so that we can see what you have in store for us. Bless us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight we're in chapter 5 of 1 Peter, which will close out 1 Peter, and we're ready to move into 2 Peter at our next session. But tonight we're going to be talking about elders or pastors or creatures feeding the flock. That's what Peter was talking about here in the fifth chapter, trying to encourage preachers to let them know that their responsibility is to feed the flock, that God's people need shepherding, that they need direction, that in a spiritual manner they need to all be following in the same direction. Because if there's not any direction, if there's no spiritual head, if there's no spiritual leading, we have a bunch of sheep that's going in every kind of direction, doing what they think that they need to do, or doing what they think is right to do, but nobody going in lockstep. Again, one of Pastor Graham's phrases, in lockstep, working together and doing things together. And so Peter is saying that it's an important thing that that the elders, that the preachers, that the pastors feed the flock, shepherd the flock, guide the flock. I think we mentioned last week and possibly the week before that in the illustration that if there is no shepherd with sheep, and God consistently used that example of sheep whenever he was speaking of his church. When sheep are not shepherded and they start grazing, they keep their heads down grazing. They're so innocent until they don't even recognize danger that's around. And so with their heads down grazing, and if there's not a shepherd to guide them, and if there's a cliff in front of them, they will graze and graze and graze until they get to the end of the cliff and then fall over to their death. And the strange thing about it is that not only would the lead sheep do that, but everyone behind him will continue doing that. They don't have the wherewithal to know to stop. They will just keep following each other until they fall over the cliff. So God is using that as an example, saying that it's a necessity for a shepherd to be present so that the flock can be guarded, first of all, and the flock can be led, the flock can be nurtured, the flock can be cared for. So Peter starts out in verse 1 in chapter 5. He says, oh, by the way, I pray that all of you did get your notes from chapter 5. Sister Cheryl did send them out. And if any of you are not getting them, please contact the church and leave a message, and we will be sure that you are added to the list so that you can receive the notes from the lessons that are being taught. Chapter 5, starting with verse 1. Peter writes, he says, the elders which are among you, or the preachers that are among you, the pastors, the spiritual leaders that are among you, he says, I lift you, I exalt you, I lift you up. And he goes on to say, who am also an elder? He's saying that not only you, but I am as well. I'm in the same predicament that you're in, that God is calling to shepherd and to lead his people. He says, and a witness of the suffering of Christ. Peter says that he's a witness to the suffering of Christ and how he had to be the tribulations and trials that he went through prior to his being nailed to the cross. Peter was a witness of that. And he goes on to say, and he's also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Peter is clearly saying to pastors, to preachers, that there is a special reward that God has in store for leaders, for pastors, and that not to be concerned that the work that is necessary for a pastor to be leading his people, that God is not recognizing it. God has a special reward for pastors. And so he is saying, keep that in mind as you're toiling day by day and night by night, that God is recognizing the work that you're doing as preachers, and that God has a special reward stored up for you. So he goes on in verse 2, and then he gives us the given instructions. He says, feed the flock of God, shepherd the flock of God, lead them, nurture them. You know, shepherds, whenever they are with their flock, you will find shepherds at times that are holding little sickly lambs in their arms. That's a common theme, you know, which gives the view that there are times when a pastor needs to lift a soldier up, needs to lift up a member, needs to prop up one of the sheep that's in the fold, that is necessary for us to keep an eye on who that we see is weak or who we see that needs that extra attention. And so he's saying to us, keep that in mind as you are shepherding your flock. You must feed them. You must do everything that's necessary for them to grow and grow in strength. So he says, feed the flock of God, which is among you. Take in the oversight thereof. And then he says, not by constraint. In other words, you're not doing it because you are forced to do it, or that you feel a strong obligation to. It should be done by love. It should be done by the Holy Spirit as he nudges our hearts, as he prepares us and giving us the insight as to what each sheep needs, that we are to respond to the Holy Spirit and deal with that sheep in that way. So he is saying, shepherd the flock and keep the oversight of them, and not because you feel you have to, but because you love them and you care for them. It is not, in the instructions that God gives pastors, is that it's his requirement for us to have a hospitality, that we love the flock, that we instantly would be sensitive to the needs of each person that's in the flock, and that when there's a need, a special need, that we respond to that need with love. Not begrudgingly, or not, oh man, here we go again type of attitude, but with rejoicing, knowing that this is what God has set us there for, that we are servants, that we are here to be sure that each one of the sheep that's in the fold receives everything that they need. We are to rejoice with them when they are rejoicing. We are to cry with them when they are hurting. We're to counsel them when they're in need of direction or in need of consoling. All of that is necessary from elders, from pastors. And so Peter is being sure that we know that God has special instructions for us when it comes to his people. That we are by obligation when he calls us, because he has strengthened us. He has given us an anointing. He's given us the ability and the strength and everything that's necessary to take care of his flock. He would not assign us if he hasn't prepared us. He has not given us the job if he has not given us the wherewithal to accomplish that work. So he says, not with by way of constraint, but willingly, and not for filthy money. You know, pastors in these days and times, you know, especially when I was working with the seminary, that's one of the things that I had to deal with young pastors that were coming along. The conversation was, how much were they going to be making? It's okay to start with a smaller church with the idea that I'm going to get paid going to a larger church, these kinds of things. And I would have to pray with them and talk with them and redirect their attention to show that there is no small church. There is no such thing as being directed to seek more money or these kinds of things, you know, the physical things that's not what God wants. If God has assigned you, this is where you are to be. If God has positioned you with a flock, that's where you are assigned to be. So we're not to be looking for where we can find the most money or the most prestige or any of that. But we are to shepherd because God has given us the anointing to do so, the direction to do so. And he goes on to finish that verse up saying, but we are to do it with a ready mind. Have our minds and our hearts set on taking care of the flock. We shouldn't have to be forced to do so. As a matter of fact, we should be so cognizant, we shouldn't be caught off guard whenever the need comes up. It shouldn't be that our minds are so attuned to other things to where we miss the fact that there is a sheep that needs attention. Suppose a shepherd is out there with his sheep and he's on his laptop or on his on Facebook or on, shepherds go, well, today, I guess they do have it. You know, in today's time, but in biblical times they didn't, of course. But the point being is that what if the shepherd was out there distracted in something else that he's enjoying or loving to do, not paying attention to the flock? And then here a wolf comes along and grab a little lamb or something, and he's gone off and have eaten it by the time that the shepherd finds out that the lamb is even missing. You know, that's why God is saying, with a ready mind, with your heart set on doing the work, so that you're able to be sure that you are watching over the flock and that you're taking care of the needs of the flock. In verse 3, still talking about the pastors feeding the flock, he says, neither as being lords over God's heritage. That's one of the main things that sometimes causes a problem. Pastors are not masters. Pastors are not masters. You know, we're not lords over the flock. The flock belongs to God, not to us, not to the pastors. We're not to be demanding to them. We are servant to them. We are to be taking care of them. We are to be watching over them. We're to be taking whatever steps necessary to be sure that they are well attended to. And that's one of the things that we need to keep in mind all the time, that we do not own the flock. We are not masters. We are not there to demand this and demand that. We are there to be a servant, to be sure that we are taking care of God's people. Moses, when he was with God's people as they came out of Egypt, and God constantly referred to his people as stubborn, as stiff-necked, you know, God called them some names. I mean, he knew what they were, and he, you know, called them out. Moses started doing the same thing. God had to correct him. God stopped him and said, Moses, no. You don't do this. These are my people. I can call them that, but you can't. They don't belong to you. They belong to me. So God is clear in that as he relates to the elders or to pastors, to leaders of his people, that we are to love them and to service them. They may be mad, they may be stiff-necked, they may be stubborn, but that's between the sheep and God. God is the owner. We are to be an example to the flock. We are to lead by example. That's one of the beautiful things about our pastor that went on to be with the Lord. His whole action was being an example. As he taught, he performed it first to let us know that this was the right thing to do. And like he would say all the time, he would never assign anything to any of us that he himself was not willing to do. You know, an example, that's so important. We are to roll our sleeves up and be in with the flock. You're not sitting up on a hill, not sitting up on the, you know, way up high, you know, away from them and so forth. We are to be in the midst of the flock, being an example. Follow me until you're strong enough to see Jesus yourself. Paul talked about that. He pastored and guided the flock that God assigned to him, he would tell them in scriptures, he says, I know that you're babies and you don't know yet. He said, but follow me. You know, do as I do until you're strong enough yourself to see Jesus. And as you grow that strong, then you can pull back from me as your follower of Christ. But we are to be examples to the flock. And then when the chief shepherd shall appear. Oh, we know who the chief shepherd is. Oh, yes, that's the Lord Jesus Christ. When the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. That's that special reward that I'm speaking of. When Christ shall come, the pastors will receive a special reward. Because Christ knows how we are attacked. He knows how we are ostracized. He knows how people treat us. Christ knows that because he himself was treated that way. And so his reward for us, as he's made it clear several times in Scripture, that we will receive a special reward, a special crown for being the pastors over the flock in the way that Christ wants us to be. Christ will reward us for that. The sleepless nights, the nights full of prayers for people that are hurting, that are in need of special attention, he's aware of that. And so when the chief shepherd shall appear, he will bless us. He will give us that special reward, that special crown of glory. And then he moves on now and starts to talking about the flock. And he's saying to the flock now, you need to learn to humble yourselves. You need to learn to humble yourselves. He's through talking, well, he's not through talking about the pastor as far as them feeding the flock. But now he's moving toward the flock themselves, the saints that we are. Or shepherding, he says, likewise, you younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Submit yourselves unto the pastor. Pastor cannot pastor if the sheep are not following him. You cannot pastor unless the people allow you to pastor them. So Peter is saying here that the sheep, they must learn to humble themselves and follow the direction of the elders. And then he goes on to say, all of you be subject one to another. You know, we're to be accountable. All of us are accountable. None of us standing alone saying, I do my thing and you don't have a word to say about it. No. We all are accountable to each other. You know, if you start seeing me stepping away from the direction that God is calling, as a brother, as a sister, you would come alongside and say, brother, pastor, look, you know, can we talk? And the same thing among each other. We are accountable to one another. That's how we keep ourselves in line, by being accountable. We should not be so stiff-necked until we're quicker to tell people, get out of our business. Be clothed with humility. Be humble. God can bless us when we're humble, when we're so full of pride. But God cannot deal with us because we got ourselves in the way. That's why in the seven things that God says he hates, pride is the number one.
Amen.
Because when pride is there, when there's so much pride, there's you're not listening to God. You're not apt to hear his direction because you are apt to want to do as you feel that you are. That's in your mind to do. Sometimes you feel like you're way above God. You know, God, that might have been good back in the days when he wrote this, but this is a new day and time. You know, we need to do it this way now. God doesn't change. He doesn't change. The same thing that he's writing, he wrote to us back 2,000 years ago in scriptures are still relevant today. If we follow God's word today, it will bless us beyond measure. And so he said, tells us to be clothed with humility. Allow people to correct us. Allow people to speak to us. Allow people to pull alongside and help us. Old Testament scripture says God resists the proud. God resists the proud. You know, we don't ever want to be in that position to where God is is resisting us because we are standing there bigger than who we are. So God says, be humble so that I can bless you. But if you're so proud, then I can't hear I can't hear what God is saying. I can't understand where he's trying to carry me. So Peter is saying to us, be clothed with humility, because God does resist those who think they're more than what they are. And when we are humble, Peter is saying, He gives grace to those who are humble. To those that are proud, he resists us. That could be the reason why sometimes that we feel that we're doing everything that God is calling us to do, but we don't see the blessings of God. Could be that we are not humble. We may be doing stuff, but we're not listening to God. We're not humble. So God says for us to be humble so that he can bless us in a special way. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. That must be an important thing because he goes to the next verse and go at it again. Humble yourselves. Humility. Humble yourselves. And here is something now that I did a research myself. Was doing a, a Bible study or at the seminary when I was teaching. The topic was on humility. And I looked throughout the whole Bible, and there was nowhere in the Bible where the Bible says for us to pray for humbleness. And everywhere it says, be humble, which gives the thought that God has given us the ability to be humble. We just choose not to. Yes, ma'am.
I used to stand still every once in a while. I have mental
blessings that God has for us, because God does bless, I like to say horizontally, from people. You know, keep in mind the sign of the cross, we are saved vertically. God saves us. Man can't save us. God saves us. So that's the vertical part if we look at the cross. But then everything after that, we receive horizontally. We receive horizontally. If we need money, God don't drop it off here on the floor. You know, amen. He causes the blessing to come horizontally. Amen. Whatever the needs that we have in life comes horizontally. But if we don't humble ourselves, like Sister Jones is saying, become stiff-necked or come, I forgot the term she used, but we will cut people off from blessing us. And that is totally correct. So God is saying through Peter, he is saying, be sure, humble yourselves. Therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exhort you in due time, in his time. God will exalt us. You know, we don't have to lift ourselves up, or we don't have to exalt ourselves. If we remain humble and allow God to guide us, God will exalt us in due time. And that exhortation, that as he exalts us, it won't be a temporary thing. It will be a lasting thing. When God does something, no man can tear it down. There may be people that are hating you when they see God exalting you, but there ain't a thing they can do about it. Because God, when God does it, it's permanent. It's not a temporary thing. When we exalt ourselves, it's a temporary thing, even if we're able to do it. And that's why also Luke, when he was teaching, he says, when we go into a place, Lord's seat. In other words, what he's saying, take the Lord attitude, allow someone else to bid you to the higher seat, because it becomes embarrassing if you come in with a higher attitude or come in taking a higher seat and then be asked to step down. It becomes an embarrassment. So being humble and taking the lower esteem, then God will come along and he will exalt us. He will lift us. He, in due time, he will put us and place us where he wants us to be. And then in verse 7, he goes on to say, cast all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. God knows where each one of us is. He knows what it is that's necessary in our lives. And he cares for us. And so he says to us that when we remain humble, he then is able to do things for us. He says, be sober. In other words, don't be not necessarily intoxicated from strong drink. That's one thing he's talking about. But he is saying, don't have things in your mind that's occupying your attention to the point that God can't speak to you. Sometimes we can be so haughty in our attitudes until we're drunk on ourselves. And so God says, be sober, have your hearts open, take the humble position so that I can speak to you, so that you can present an example of me working through you. Because that's why you are saved and left here, is to be my example. But Jesus was never halted. He never came in and lifted himself up. He allowed the Father to exalt him. Be vigilant. Have your mind clear so that you can see what God is directing you to do. Not clouded up over pride or clouded up over what you think that you ought to do or how you ought to do it before you hear from God and how he wants you to do it. Be vigilant. Be vigilant. Have your mind on him. Because the devil, he's right there. He's seeing this. He will have you doing junk that you'd be, I mean, that's out of this world. If Satan has his way with you, he can have you falling all over the place, doing things to really embarrass yourself and God. That's what his job is, and he's good at that. He is our adversary. And he goes about this, I mean, loudly. The Bible describes it as a roaring lion. I mean, he doesn't do, well, he does do it quietly as well, but he boasts. He really wants it loud because he wants to see others. He wants others to see how he's destroying a person of God, a man or a woman of God. And so he goes after people very aggressively. That's what the scripture is saying about him going about in a roaring as a lion. He's doing it aggressively because he wants others to see how he's able to distract a brother or sister. He knows that he can't have it. Because once you belong to God, once you're a child of God, he can never have you. But he can have you disgracing God. He can have you shaming God. He can have you doing things that would be embarrassing to the kingdom. And so Peter is saying, with you being humble and being vigilant and having your mind clear and being sober, that you can be in tune to the Holy Spirit and have him guide you, rather than the adversary, Satan, jumping in there and guiding you. Because there's nothing good that he's going to lead you to. It may look good for the moment. It may feel good for the moment. That is when Satan is doing it. But his intention is to destroy and to kill. It is never to do good. No matter how pretty it looks, if Satan is guiding it, the end result is destruction. Resist steadfast in the faith. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same affliction are accomplished in your brother that are in the world. In other words, what he's saying is that all of us that are involved in this work, we suffer the same afflictions. It may be at different levels, but we are all suffering the same afflictions. No one is suffering something different than what the other is. It might be under a different category, but we are all suffering afflictions. But when we have our mind set on Christ again, when we allow Him to guide us, He can fix it to where those sufferings will wind up strengthening us rather than hurting us. And so Peter is saying that we have to keep our minds and our hearts humble and steadfast on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then 10 through 14 winds up being the benediction that Peter is presenting for that for his first letter. And he says, "For the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that he hath suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silas, a faithful brother unto you, as I consider him, I have written briefly, exalting and testifying that this is the true grace of God wherein you stand. The church that is at Babylon, elect together with you, saluteth you, and so doeth Mark, my son. Greet you one another with a kiss of love. Peace be with you, all that are in Christ Jesus. Amen." And that is the finishing of his letter, his first letter to the church. Now next week we will open up the second epistle of Peter, the second letter of Peter, and go forth and study that. I don't think I saw any questions that was on the sheet. No, I don't see any questions. Kind of tough doing both things, looking for the for questions and presentation, but I don't see it. For that, I want to go ahead and give a how the old folks used to say, "Open the doors of the church." That used to be so cute.
Yeah.
But we have taught about the Lord Jesus Christ. Want to offer to anyone that the Holy Spirit has spoken to tonight the opportunity to give their life to the Lord Jesus Christ if they haven't. That's an important issue to consider because time is winding down, as we would say. It's getting closer and closer. And it's important that you know the Lord Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sins. And if you don't know him, right now the church is giving you an opportunity to come into the realm of safety. If there is someone that need a church home, that do not have a church home, I would ask you to call the church at 904-356-2359. Give the church a call and there will be someone to answer and get back with you to make it very easy for you to become a part of this family. So with that, I believe we've done what God has asked. That's the end to our lesson for tonight. One announcement that I know of, Saturday morning at 11 o'clock, we have the homeboy service for Sister Massey. I would ask that each of you that is able to please come and support the family. It's a time where there's grief, and there's a time where it's physically emptiness that has come about with the homegoing of the saint. The saint, yes, is in glory with the Lord Jesus Christ, but physically there is an emptiness. And it means so much to family if there's people that are blessing them, people that are with them at a time like this. So if you have the time, please come and support the family on Saturday morning at 11 o'clock here at St. Joseph. With that, have a wonderful week. Look to see you Saturday morning. If not, if God permits, we'll see you Sunday morning. God bless and have a wonderful evening.